Bearings allow things to spin freely while fixed structurally in place. Using bearings with your 3D prints is actually really simple, but I wanted to make this video to compile all of the best practices that I wish I had known when I was first getting started. A bearing has an inner ring and an outer ring. The only contact between the two rings is through a little sheath of steel balls that sits in between. The reason this works is because if you think about a sphere is a three-dimensional object that has an infinite number of points that are all an equal distance from the center. So the only contact between the theoretical perfect sphere and the ring of a ball bearing should be a point that is 1 over infinity in surface area. So naturally, as with anything, there's going to be a million different types of bearings, but these are the type that I normally use, and this is the type that I will be talking about exclusively in this video. The principles still apply to other types, but this is what I found is the best for working with 3D printing. It's a good size, it's a good strength, it's a good middle ground for a lot of things. So this is the 608RS bearing. There's also a normal 608 and a 608-2Z that is often mistyped as ZZ, but it's the same thing. The difference is the RS comes with these little rubber seals that you can take off if you need to. The normal one doesn't come with any seal, and the 2Z comes with a steel seal that is not intended to be taken off so that the factory lubricant cannot be removed. Now, speaking of factory lubricant, the same thing happens anytime anybody buys these bearings. You get a little pack of them, and you try spinning them, and you say, well, these kind of suck. They don't spin very well. Well, it's because they're greased for a high-stress application. These bearings, the reason they're so cheap is because they're made for skateboards and rollerblades. That means that they're taking the entire weight of a person on this little thing. So they're greased to be able to dissipate that heat, deal with all that high stress and high shear force. But most of the time when I'm using these, I don't use anywhere near that kind of force. So I just take a little WD-40 and I just spray it into the seal and work it a little bit, and that'll loosen it right up. It'll spin like nobody's business. You'll see some people online say, well, that's gonna ruin your bearing. It won't. It would ruin your bearing if you then used it in a high stress application, but assumedly if you're using WD-40, that's why you're using it, is because you know it's not going to be. So all of my windmills, I use WD-40 on the bearings to get them to spin freely because there would be a lot of resistance with that grease on the inside if I didn't do so. As for buying these bearings, I usually get them on AliExpress, but I checked for this video and it looked like they were a little bit more expensive than Amazon. So I'll put an unaffiliated link in the description for a 100 pack of bearings. It's pretty good. In general though, you shouldn't be paying more than like 25 cents per bearing, and that will go down a lot too as you buy in bulk. There's a little bit of a learning curve when it comes to mounting bearings. If all you do is make a 22 millimeter hole, you're gonna be in for a really rude awakening when you try to put your bearing in that hole. It won't fit. Most 3D printers use a nozzle that's 0.4 millimeters wide. If you feed a model into your slicer, and that model has a feature that needs to be 22 millimeters in diameter, well, your slicer doesn't know if that needs to be at least 22 millimeters or at most 22 millimeters. So what it's going to do is it's going to have the print head trace a 22 millimeter line, and whatever happens, happens. This means that if you have a 0.4 millimeter nozzle, there's going to be roughly a 0.2 millimeter squish on either side of the 22 millimeter diameter feature. There are many ways to combat this, and I'll go over a couple of them. The easiest way is to just make the holes in your model slightly bigger than the diameter of your bearing. I found a good estimate to be the actual outer diameter of your bearing plus between 53 to 60% of the diameter of your nozzle. So for these 608 bearings, it's going to be 22 plus between 53 to 60% of 0.4. which will give you a number that's somewhere in the range of 22.22 to 22.3. I also highly recommend that you document all of your findings. Write down your measurements when you design a part, and then document how well the parts actually fit when you incorporated them. That way, next time you're designing something and you're incorporating one of the same parts, like these bearings, you can also then adjust your tolerances as needed. There is kind of a balance that you have to achieve with this though, because very often I make holes that are too big and my bearings end up falling out. If you're worried about your bearings falling out, you can also dab a little bit of cyanoacrylate glue around the edge before you put it into place. Super glue tends to bond really well with 3D prints, and I found that it bonds pretty well with bearings as well. On the other hand, if you find that the hole that you're trying to mount your bearing in is just a little bit too tight, you can either smack it with a mallet, or you can use a bolt and a wrench to persuade it into place. A nut and a bolt together perform one of the most simple forms of linear actuation. As you spin the nut or the bolt, they become closer together. So if you have a bearing between the nut and the bolt, the more you crank them, the more torque is going to pull the two ends together, thus forcing the bearing into place. I found that this works pretty well if your hole is just a little bit too tight, but if your hole is much too tight, you're just going to end up breaking your part. Another easy way that you can make sure that your bearings are firmly in place is by mounting a knurled nut into your 3D print. Knurled nuts are a part that were kind of bastardized from woodworking into 3D printing, and in fact, most shops make them now specifically for people that use 3D printed parts. They're made out of brass, which is highly conductive, and you can mount them into holes using a soldering iron. Then when the nut is firmly mounted in your 3D print, you can screw a bolt into it. This bolt will press against the outer diameter of your bearing and ensure that it stays mounted tightly. As I started screwing the bolt in, it started deforming my part. This is not from the heat of my soldering iron, but from the force of screwing that bolt into the bearing. This method is probably best for thicker parts. There's a little bit of consideration that you have to do when you're designing a shaft. You want to have no contact at all between parts that are attached to the inner ring and those that are attached to the outer ring. That's kind of the whole point of a bearing. The inner ring is just barely wider than the seal. This is nice because then things can sit on the inner ring of the bearing and have a width all the way up to that of the outer bearing without anything touching. I like to use hex bolts as my shafts for things. If you're using SAE, 5/16 nuts and bolts are the largest you can get that will still fit into the inner diameter of the bearing. Otherwise, use M8 nuts and bolts. The size that bolts are quoted at is just over what their actual size is. This means that M8 bolts are not actually 8mm. They're slightly lower. This means that when you put an M8 bolt or a 5/16 bolt into the inner diameter of the bearing, there's going to be just a little bit of backlash. This isn't a big deal as long as your shaft isn't carrying anything heavy and your shaft isn't very long. This is because if it has room, the bolt will act like a lever against the bearing. The longer the shaft, the greater the length of the arc that it has room to trace from the backlash. To fix this, there is somewhat of an easy way and a proper way. The easy way is to just take some plumber's tape and wrap it around the threads of the bolt until it takes just a little bit of force to slip it into the bearing. At that point, the diameter of the shaft of the bolt will more closely match that of the bearing, and the slop will be lessened significantly. The more proper way to fix it is by adding a second bearing at the other end of the shaft. This almost acts like a choke for the bolt, preventing it from moving outside of that 8mm diameter, even at the extremities. And lastly, just a few more miscellaneous considerations when you're incorporating bearings into your 3D printed parts. You want everything to be tight, but not too tight. If you use the two bearing system like I recommended, it may seem like a good idea to put one nut on the far side and have your bolt be on the near side, but if you crank them together, the shaft won't want to spin. I don't know why this is, somebody in the comments might tell me, but the bearings will just lock up until eventually it frees itself, and when it frees itself it won't be secure at all, and it can often undo itself. Also, there are a few different types of bolts that are specifically made for mounting bearings. I don't know enough about the nuances between the different types, but I've tried all of them and I haven't had much success. There are lag bolts, carriage bolts, and shoulder bolts, which all seem like basically the same idea. They have a shaft for a little bit, and then the bolt starts. I found that these specialty bolts are just as susceptible to all the problems that I talked about in this video, but they're much, much more expensive. So I gave up on trying to use them and I just used my methods instead. Lastly, just my final recommendation after everything that I've talked about today, the system that I find works best is two bearings as far away from each other as they can be, friction fit into the part that you've designed. I found that this system is the most reliable and the most easy to design. As I find myself saying all the time though, there are so many different ways to do things, find what works best for you and stick with it. Experiment around and see what you can do. You might surprise yourself.
Who knew talking about bearings could be so fun? Aren't you glad you stayed here for the whole video? Well, either way, I am grateful for you, and I hope you have a wonderful night. Be sure to like and subscribe and leave a comment if I missed anything, or if you have any tips for anybody else. Much love.